Okay, so we will now get started. So hi everyone, welcome to Millie's Guide to Volunteering CAS for high school students. So today we're gonna talk about everything you need to know about CAS. If you have any questions, feel free to pop them in the Q&A box. I'll try and get around to all of them if I can and answer them to the best of my abilities. So let's get started. So here's a bit about me. So my name is Yadavi. There's my email address. If you have any questions, please do feel free to contact me. So I was born and raised in London in the UK. And when I was 11 years old, I moved to Switzerland for 5 years. I lived in the French speaking part of Switzerland near Geneva. And so there I did my IGCSEs in the school there. Then for the last 2 years of schooling, I came back to the UK where I did my IB. So for my IB, I took higher level economics, maths, applications, interpretations, and English language and literature. And at standard level, I took psychology, French language and literature, and physics, and I scored 44 points overall. So now I'm an incoming student at the University of Warwick, where I'll be studying economics, psychology, and philosophy. So over the summer holidays between now and when I go to university in September, I've been interning as a content writer at Millie, where I've been writing blog articles on the IB and about UK universities. So today we're going to be talking about CAS, which is one of the blog articles I've written about. So if you are interested in more information, please do go and check that out. So what will we be covering today? Today we're going to talk about what is CAS, the different elements of CAS, like the CAS project, and we're going to go into some tips about CAS. So first we'll start off with, obviously, what is CAS and why is it so important? Then we will go on to the three elements of CAS. CAS stands for creativity, action, and service. So we're going to talk about all three of those elements. Then we'll go on to talk about the CAS project, which is another part of the CAS program. And lastly, we'll finish up with some tips on how to ace CAS. So first up, let's get started on what is CAS and why is it so important. So CAS is part of something called the IB Core. Now, for those of you who perhaps don't know much about the IB or haven't started the IB yet, I'll first explain what that is. So the IB stands for the International Baccalaureate. It is an international high school diploma program. And in the IB, you're scored out of 45 points. So 42 of those points come from your 6 subjects. So you take 3 subjects at a high level and 3 at a standard level. And those last 3 points that make up the 45 come from the IB core. Now in the IB core, you have something called the extended essay, which is a 4,000 words research and essay project. You have a philosophy-like subject, which is compulsory, called theory of knowledge, and then you have CAS. So the idea of CAS is to make sure that students do something other than just studying. With the immense workload of the IB, it's very easy to just spend all of your time sitting at a desk, looking at a screen, revising, or practicing for a test. But the IB's point of CAS is to make sure that students also try something new, learn a new skill, and give back to their community, maybe go outside, do some sports. In other words, do something other than just studying. It's there to make you into a more multifaceted and diverse person with more skills. And this also helps to improve your mental and physical health, because trust me, sitting at a screen the whole day revising is not good for your fit mental or physical health. So CAS is there to make sure that you do something other than just studying. So how does it work? It works by you should be continually doing at least one element of CAS all through the IB. Now, this doesn't mean that you should be doing a creativity, an action, and a service all at the same time, because trust me, no IB student will have the time for that. Instead, it means you should perhaps be doing a couple of months of a creativity, then a couple of months of action, and finishing up with a couple of months of a service, and perhaps doing your CAS project, which we'll discuss later, over the summer holidays. A little side note here, yes, that does mean that you are expected to continue with CAS over the holidays, but if you plan your CAS timeline well, this shouldn't be too much of a burden on you. You should also provide regular evidence and reflections of your progress for all of your CAS activities. Now we're going to talk about evidence and reflections in a bit more detail later on, but just for some context, evidence is there to show that you've done the activity, and reflections are there to show what you've learned and what you've gained from the activity. You will also have regular interviews with your CAS supervisor. So at the start of your IB, you will be assigned a CAS supervisor, and they are basically there to answer any questions you may have, give some help if you're stuck on something for CAS, make sure you're doing all the elements of CAS, and to conduct these interviews. Now, these interviews are nothing to panic about. They're really chill. All they're there to do is to ask how you're doing with CAS, what you've enjoyed about your activities, what you perhaps haven't enjoyed so much, and a few general questions about your experience with CAS. It's basically another way of ensuring that you're actually doing CAS. And lastly, after you've completed each activity for CAS, the way that you move on to the next one is by asking your supervisor to complete a supervisor review. In this, they basically say that this student has completed this activity, here are a few comments about them doing the activity, and now this is ticked off, they can move on to the next one. So that's how you finish a CAS activity. And again, a little reminder, CAS is an ongoing process. While it may be very tempting to try and finish CAS off in the first couple of months of your IB, this isn't possible. You are expected to continue with CAS throughout the 2 years. And also it's good for you mentally and physically to be doing something other than just studying for the 2 years if you're IB. So there's a couple of benefits with it. So why is CAS so important? In short, the answer to this is that you need to pass CAS to pass your IB. While CAS isn't graded like other elements of the IB are, it's a pass or fail system. And while it's really easy to pass, it is still possible to fail. And regardless of how well you've done in your other six subjects, if you fail CAS, you will fail your IB. So all you need to do to pass CAS is complete the activities, have evidence and reflection for these activities, and do a CAS project. It's really easy, it's really manageable with the workload. It's completely possible to do it. Another reason why it's so important, especially for the IB, is that it's one of the core elements of the IB. And it's what makes the IB a much more holistic diploma program than a lot of other diploma programs across the world, because it has that onus on focusing on things other than just studying. And it shows the IB's importance of making people more multifaceted and diverse than just people who just study. So I said we go on to talk about reflections. So reflections, like I said before, are to show what you've learned from the activity. The IB is not looking for superficial descriptions about what the activity was. They're looking more about what you learned from it, what you enjoyed, what you maybe didn't enjoy at all, and why, and what you took away from the activity. So on the screen now, you can see 7 learning outcomes. These are given by the IB for you to focus your reflections. So for example, for each activity, you should have around 3 learning outcomes that go with the activity. And for each learning outcome, you should have 1 meaningful reflection. So for context, if you were doing swimming as your action activity, you could have strength and growth as one of your learning outcomes, where you perhaps talk about how you grew in strength through your swimming. Then you can have challenge and skills as your second learning outcome, where you can talk about the challenges that you were faced with and how you overcame them and the skills that you gained while overcoming those challenges. And then you could perhaps have the 5th one, showing perseverance and commitment, as your 3rd learning outcome, where you could talk about how you stayed committed to swimming despite your other school IB commitments, and how that was showing your perseverance to stay committed to the activity despite the challenges that you may have faced. So that's a little example of how reflections are supposed to go. They don't need to be an essay for each reflection, but it should be around 1 or 2 meaningful paragraphs about what the activity meant for you. Now on to evidence. Evidence is by far one of the easiest parts of the CAS program. All you need to do for evidence is show that you've done the activity. So this can be a picture of you doing the activity. It can be a screenshot or a picture of your Apple Watch or Fitbit if it shows how far you've run, if that applies to your activity. If you've done a walk or a run for your activity and you have apps that map out your route, you could take a screenshot of that. You can have an audio recording if you've had a meeting for your activity and you want to upload that. Or you could even have, if you created a piece of work for your activity, you can upload that, and anything really can be an evidence for CAS. This is the easiest part of CAS, don't worry about it. Just anything to prove that you've actually done what you're saying you've done. So now that we've talked about what CAS is, why it's important, how it works, we're going to go on to the main elements of CAS. But before we do that, I'll just check if there are any questions at this point. Throughout the presentation, I'll keep pausing to see if there are any questions. If you do have any, please do feel free to ask. If there is anything right now, then we'll go back to the presentation. So now we're going to talk about the 3 elements of CAS, this being creativity, action, and service. So first up, creativity. A creativity can be anything at all that is creative, artistic, or musical. In other words, anything that is not a sports or service. And the great thing about it is that it's probably something that you're already doing at home, and you just need to fit it in with your other IB commitments. So we're going to talk about some examples of what you could do for creativity. So 1 is baking or cooking. These are also really good skills when you go to university, when most likely you'll be cooking for yourself. So it's a good skill to learn. You could learn an instrument, or if you're already playing an instrument, you could play that at a school band or orchestra. You could take up painting or sketching. You could take up knitting, or maybe making your own clothes if you have a sewing machine. You could take up calligraphy. You could join a choir either in your local area or in your school. You could start a podcast. On Millie's website, we have a webinar and a blog article on how to start your own podcast for beginners. They are really great resources if that's something that interests you. I think the link should be in the chat, so do go ahead and check that. For CAS, you could even take up photography, make homemade candles. And this last one, Model United Nations Club, is a really good one for creativity in CAS. It's what I personally did. And you learn so many skills of public speaking, global awareness. You get to meet so many people. And another tip, UK universities really value the skills you gain from MUN. So if you put that on your personal statement, it'll really elevate your personal statement in the university's eyes because they know it's a very valuable club to be attending. So that's a really good one for creativity if your school does offer that. So next up is action. So action is any kind of sport or exercise that gets your heart rate up. It can be a team sport, like going to a football or basketball club, or it can be more for personal fitness. It's really up to you. So again, some examples. So you could do jogging or running. You could join your local gym. Again, both of these would be examples of personal fitness. If you have a green thumb, you could do gardening, which is surprisingly tiring. So yes, it does count for action. You could do outdoor adventure activities. By this, I mean like those tree rope courses like Go Ape in the UK. Those are really fun activities for day trips and they're also great for team building. You could join a dance class or a self-defense class, which is a really good skill for when you're living on your own. You could even take up cycling or walking to school if you wanted to, which is good also for the environment. You could try out swimming if you have a swimming pool near your house. You could take up hiking if you have hiking areas near your place. Or this last one, yoga, is probably the easiest one to do right from your room. When you're taking a study break, just put on a YouTube tutorial on how to do yoga. Do that for a bit, and that'll be a great one to do for CAS. And last up, we're going to talk a bit about service. So, does it count for CAS? This is one of the fundamental IB questions that every IB student will ask. Sometime during IB, you will probably ask it, or you will hear one of your friends ask it. This is because service is typically seen as one of the harder parts of the IB CAS program to do, because a lot of people struggle on what to do for service. So whenever any teacher or any member of staff asks for volunteers at an after-school club or help out at some kind of event, the first thing that any IB student will ask before committing to it is saying, does it count for CAS? So this is something you'll be hearing a lot of during your IB. So to make sure that you're not one of those students who's scrambling to find what to do for service, we're going to talk about what service is and again, some examples of what you could do for service. So for the IB CAS program, service is anything at all where you help someone else, but you cannot be paid for it. For all parts of the CAS program, if you are paid for the activity you're doing, you either have to give that money away for charity or you cannot count as CAS. Remember, you cannot be paid for CAS, unfortunately. The service can be as big or as small as you like because everything makes a difference. So it's really up to what resources you have available to you and the time you have available to you given your other IB commitments with the workload. So some examples, one is tutoring. This is probably one of the easiest to do for CAS simply because you can tutor any skill or any subject that you're really good at. You can tutor it to a younger child or sibling. And you can do after-school tutoring sessions if you're doing it in person. Or during the lockdown, or if you prefer, you could do more online tutoring via Zoom. So there's a lot of flexibility that goes with tutoring, and it's a really easy one for the service portion of CAS. You'd also take part in a charity fun run like Race for Life or Tough Mudder. You could do a school bake sale. You could volunteer to help out at after-school clubs in your school or in your local area. Or you could help out at a local grocery store for a couple of months. You could offer to mow a neighbor's lawn for free, however. Or you could volunteer at an animal shelter. If you have a beach or any nature reserve area near your place, you could do a cleanup off the area, or you can organize a charity car wash. Or this last one, which really depends if your school offers these, is you could sign up to a volunteer trip if it's run by your school. By this, I mean, for example, my school runs trips called Project Nepal, where they would take students into Nepal for a couple of weeks, and there they would help to build schools for local children. And they would interact with the local population, with the local culture. They'd spend a day going around Kathmandu. It was such a great experience. They all thoroughly enjoyed it and they learned so much from it. So that was a really, really meaningful CAS service experience. And for a lot of them, it was their CAS project, which is what we'll discuss a bit later. So if your school does run any trips like that, or you're able to go on a trip like that outside of your school program, I would highly recommend it. There's such great experiences for you to do. So now that you know what the three elements of CAS are, I'm going to tell you what I did for CAS just for some context. So like I said, I joined Model United Nations for the creativity portion, and I also play the piano and the violin. So I play the violin in one of my school orchestras. So those are my two creativity activities. And I did those for, I think I did it for the first year of the IB. Then for the action portion, I used to go swimming. And then I also used to go to the gym. So those are my two action activities. The gym one was especially good during lockdowns because when obviously we couldn't go outside, gyms were closed. It was a really easy one to transfer to my home environment. All I needed to do was buy a few resistance bands, some weights, and I could continue my gym exercises at home because one of the CAS expectations was that you continued even during the pandemic. So you adapted somehow. So that was a really easy one for me to adapt. Then for service, what I did was I used to tutor a younger child in school in maths. So I would do weekly after school tutoring sessions for him. And then I also started an economics book club. This was actually my CAS project. So basically I'm an economics major. So I thought since I'm interested in economics, but I used to find it sometimes hard to read nonfiction economics books or articles like the Financial Times, how about if I help other people to do that? So other people who are interested in economics, but perhaps don't want to read too many nonfiction texts, maybe if I can help them to get a passion in that, that would be a really good club. So we would choose an economic text or article to read, give people time to read it, and then have a bit of a discussion debate around it. And that made it much more, it brought the book to life and it made it much more accessible for people to read. And it also raised an interest in those topics. So that was what my service activities were, and that's what I did for CAS. So again, like I mentioned before, there is also the CAS project, which is another element of CAS, which we're going to talk about now. But before we do that, I'll again just pause the presentation, see if there are any questions. If you do have any questions, please do feel free to ask me. I've just finished the IB, so the CAS is still fresh in my mind. So if you have any questions, please feel free to ask. Okay, if no one still has any questions, then we'll go back to the presentation, but there will be more opportunities later if you do have anything or if anything comes up. So now we're going to talk about the CAS project. So what is a CAS project? It is a project, obviously, that covers one or more of the three CAS elements. So it can be a CAS project solely focused on creativity or action or service, or it can be a combination of the two, which is usually what most people end up doing. Or in some cases, it can be a combination of all three elements of CAS. So it really depends on what you choose and what you want to do. You usually do the CAS project for a sustained period of time. So it's a much longer process than your other CAS activities. And also because of this, it's a more holistic approach than your other CAS activities. By this, I mean there's usually a lot more planning, thought, and consideration that goes into planning this CAS project. So now you can see four attributes that the IB has given that go with the CAS project. So one, it has to be collaborative. This can mean working with a pair or in a three, or it can mean working in a really big group. It has to be a series of sequential CAS experiences. It should be well considered, meaning that you've taken some time and thought to plan it. And it should have a good organization and structure, meaning you should know what your end goal is, and you should know what the mini goals are that you have to achieve to reach that end goal. So how do you plan a great CAS project? The first step is definitely just sitting down, brainstorming and planning what you want to do. You also want to think about the different combinations of CAS elements you could have. So like I said, typically people do two CAS elements for their CAS project. So usually people combine service with action or service with creativity, although service is one of the best ones to do for the CAS project, which is why a lot of people combine that with other things. But like I said, you could do just one of the CAS elements or all three. It really depends on what the activity is that you want to pursue. Also for the group and the collaboration aspect, you could do the CAS project in a really big group, like what Project Nepal was for my school, where there'd be about 15, 20 people who would go on the trip and work together. Or it can be a more small group thing, like what my book club was, where it was about five or six of us who were working together to do the book club. And lastly, you also want to think about the time frame that you want to achieve this in. Like I said, the CAS project is done for a more sustained period of time, but also you want to think about the goals you want to achieve within that time period. So maybe if you're working towards a big goal, how do you want to split that up so that by the end of the CAS project, you've completed everything that you want to. And again, little tip, turning a service into a project is so much easier because service activities usually involve a lot of planning anyways. So they're really good ones. So now we're going to talk a little bit about if you wanted to combine a service with a creativity or an action and how you would turn that into a CAS project. So we're going to go through 5 examples of creativity activities and how you would turn each of those into a CAS project. So the first one is baking. If you were doing baking for creativity, you could turn that into a CAS project by perhaps planning and promoting a bake sale. So you could have a planning stage where you plan what you want, when you want to have the bake sale, how much money perhaps you're aiming to raise. Then you could create promotion posters and flyers to go around your school to promote your bake sale. Then you would do the actual baking. And then you would make it maybe set up stalls, have your bake sale, and whatever money you receive, give it to charity. If you're interested in knitting or perhaps making your own clothes or dresses on a sewing machine, you could create a plan to knit clothes or sew them and sell them on Depop. That would also be a really good CAS project, and then you give the money away to charity of your choice. If you play an instrument and some friends of yours play an instrument, you could start a small band with them and maybe play at the end of year concerts or Christmas concerts or wherever you really want. If you're part of a club at school that's a creative club, you could help out in the running of that club. Some of my friends who had been doing MUN a lot more before me, who had more experience with it, they decided that instead of just participating in the club, they'd actually want to help out in the running of that club. So they took on a more leadership role where they would chair the debates, they would help out newcomers, make sure they knew what they were doing, and they would just in generally help out with the running of MUN. So that's also worked as a CAS project. And lastly, if you're good at painting or really any kind of creative skill, you could turn that into a CAS project by teaching that to a younger child or sibling and having tutoring sessions for them. So now for turning action into a CAS project, we're going to go through again 5 examples of action activities and turning that into a project format. So if you're into jogging or running, you could plan and take part in a charity fun run where you plan your training schedule, plan when you want to be ready to do the charity fun run and then actually do it. If you're interested in hiking, you could again have a training schedule and do a sponsored hiking trip. If you're in a sports team at school, like my friends did with MUN, you could help out in the running of the sports club at school where you sometimes participate in it and sometimes help out in a more managerial role of running the club. If you like football, you could plan a local football tournament for charity, either in your local area or in your school. And lastly, if you have a green thumb and you like gardening, you could turn this into a CAS project by planting and maintaining a garden in school. While this would also make the area in school look a lot nicer, it's also so fulfilling to see a garden flourish. So I understand that was a lot of information about the 3 elements of CAS. So now we're going to go on into a few tips on the 3 elements of CAS and the CAS project. But once again, I'll just pause for a few seconds, see if there are any questions. If there are, please feel free to ask them. I'll just give you guys a couple of seconds to do that. Still no questions. Don't worry, even when I used to watch webinars in school, none of my friends would ask questions, so it's fine, don't worry. But if you do have any, please feel free to ask them later on. So now we're going to talk about some tips on how to ace CAS. First up, top tips for creativity. The first one is do something that you love and that you'll want to stay committed to. This kind of applies for all of the elements of CAS, but more so for creativity. Because one mistake that I've seen with a lot of my friends is that they chose creativity activities that they thought would be easy to do, easy to finish, but something that they didn't actually enjoy. And what ended up happening was either they wouldn't do the activity, or they would kind of do it half-heartedly, but they wouldn't write the reflections. And what would happen is by the end of the year, when they were trying to start revising for end of year exams, their CAS supervisor would be chasing them up the wall saying, you haven't done this activity, you haven't done the reflections, you need to finish off before the end of the year. And it just became a big mess where they were trying to revise, but also trying to finish off CAS. So if you do something that you actually like, chances are that you'll stay committed to it. You'll do the reflections as well because you have something to reflect on. And you'll be able to tick off that activity and move on to the next one without having pending things on your CAS timeline. Also, a creativity is a great one for the CAS project, simply as there is a lot of easy planning that goes into it. For example, buying materials, planning for a bake sale, for example, having promotion posters. There's a lot of relatively easy planning that goes into a creativity, so it's a good one for a CAS project to combine with a service or to do just on its own. And lastly, creativity activities are one of those that's a slightly more time consuming in the CAS spectrum. So it's a good idea to finish it off before the exam revision crunch starts. So like I said at the beginning of this presentation, you should be doing CAS continually throughout the 2 years. But if you plan your CAS timeline well, then by around February, March, maybe April of the second year of your IB, you should be able to take everything off for CAS, wrap everything up and finish off so that you are completely done with CAS by definitely around April of your IB second year. So you can start focusing on pure revision for mocks and your final May exams. So if you finish off a creativity well within the second year of your IB, it means that it's not lagging into that time when you want to start finishing CAS up and wrapping things up. So now on to top tips for action. So an action activity is slightly harder to make into a CAS project simply due to the limited scope of planning. So if you're combining this with a service, like in the examples we discussed before, that would still be okay because there's that service element that provides the planning layer of it. But if you're just wanting to do solely an action for a CAS project, that might be slightly more difficult because it's harder to make into a meaningful project rather than just an activity. So if you are really passionate about that, then I'd suggest you talk to your CAS supervisor and they can advise you on how to make that into a CAS project. But I personally would suggest if you like the idea of doing an action CAS project, combine it with a service in some way. However, action is a great activity to do over the summer holidays. Sorry to burst your bubble, but over the summer holidays, you will have a lot of work for the IB. You'll probably have your first draft of your extended essay. You may even have some internal assessment drafts to work on, and you definitely should be at least starting to revise and make notes for your final exams. So it won't be a free summer, and on top of that, if you have to do CAS, it can become a lot. But action activities are really good ones to make sure that you stay fit and healthy over summer, make sure that you actually go outside and do some active for a bit, and they don't take away too much time from doing the things you actually want to do over the summer holidays. So it's a really good one for that. And lastly, which is a tip that I use a lot, is that individual action activities are way more flexible than scheduled team clubs. So a lot of my action activities, both of them, swimming and gym, were more personal fitness activities where I was the one who controlled when I would do them, how often I would do them. But a lot of my friends who were in the volleyball club or the basketball club, when they had loads of assignments from school, like math assignments, internal assessments, drafts, presentations to do, and they also had a volleyball club at the end of the day, it became quite hard for them to schedule their work around that because they couldn't obviously just shirk those commitments. But for me, I could easily say, okay, I have a lot of schoolwork. I have to push my CAS to the next week. And that's fine because it's me planning what I'm doing. So when you are thinking about the activities that you want to do for action, just make sure you have a bit of flexibility and a bit of room to grow and to move around with your other IB commitments, because as you do progress with the IB, the workload will start building up quite quickly. And you want to have that room for flexibility if you do need to push things around to make sure that you're staying on top of your IB workload. Now on to top tips for service. So again, like creativity, but probably more so for service, it's one of the most time-consuming elements of the three CAS strains. So it's a good idea to finish as early as possible. While you do need to be doing CAS, at least in the beginning part of the second year of your IB, a service is a good one to maybe finish off in those first few months after you've just come back from the summer holidays, so that when you come up to the time for mocks, you can finish up CAS, you don't have a service activity that's pending, and you can start wrapping things up to finish CAS off and solely revise for your final May exams. So try and finish it as early as possible, is what I'm saying. Service, like I've said many times, is one of the best for a CAS project, simply due to the wide scope of planning and consideration that usually goes into a service activity, which is very easy to then transfer into a CAS project, or combined with other CAS elements to make into a CAS project. And lastly, a good way to think about service activities, if you are stuck on what to do, is find something that you're good at or that you enjoy and turn that into something you can give. For example, if you're good at a subject, if you've got maths or economics or English, you could turn that into something you can give by teaching that to a younger child or a younger sibling. Or if you're good at making something, for example, if you play an instrument and you're really good at playing the instrument, or if you're good at art, you can maybe play a piece for a concert for somewhere. You can go to an old age home and play some music for them. You could create some art pieces and donate those to charity. You can do anything. So find something you're good at or something that you enjoy doing and turn that into something you can give someone else, and automatically you've got yourself a service. So that's a good way to think about it if you are struggling on things to do for service. And lastly, our top tips for the CAS project. So when you're thinking about that collaboration aspect that goes into the CAS project, think about the idea of the reduced workload of working with others versus the greater flexibility of working in a small group. By that I mean, for example, with my school, they used to do the project Nepal trip, like I said. If you're working with a big group of people, and you'd probably have a bit less to do because the workload is split amongst more people, and then you have a bit less to do, which was very helpful when you have a lot of other activities. However, if you're working in a much smaller group, like I did with book club, there's a bit more flexibility because there are less people depending on you. And that means that you can maybe say, look, guys, I have a really busy week this week. Can we push a meeting to next week, perhaps? And because you don't have 15, 20, or even more people depending on you, you have maybe two or three, it's much easier for everyone to say, yeah, that's fine, we'll move it to the next week. So when you are thinking about your CAS project, think about the flexibility you get of working in a small group versus the reduced workload of working in a larger group, and think about what would work best for you. So a good way to think about the CAS project is that it can involve any of the CAS elements, just add planning. This planning element usually comes from service quite well, but it can be any of the CAS elements, just add a bit of planning to it. And lastly, probably most importantly, don't leave the CAS project to the last minute and forget about it. One of the biggest mistakes that I've seen my friends make when they were doing CAS is they would forget to do the CAS project because either they would say, oh, I'll do it after my action's over, I'll do it after the creativity, I'll do it over summer, or, oh, I'll do it like just at the beginning of year two of the IB when we come back from the summer holidays. And while I'm sure they meant to do it, what would end up happening is that they would forget about it, it would keep getting pushed back, and when they were trying to close up CAS to start revising for their final exams, they would still have the CAS project to do and they'd be scrambling to do it as well as revising. Trust me, that is not a situation you want to be in. It's much better to finish off the CAS project early so it's not pushing into that time when you want to start wrapping CAS up. A good tip is to either finish it in the first year of your IB where the workload is relatively less, or do it over the summer holidays if you're willing to do that. So another friendly reminder, don't forget about CAS. It's super important. I know it might not seem like that right now when you have loads of other things to worry about, but trust me, one, it's good. It's important for you because you need to pass CAS to pass your IB. It's good for your mental and physical health. And two, having finished the IB, I can definitely say I do see the value of CAS and I see how it's made me into a much more well-rounded person. I've learned so many skills from CAS and hopefully you will see that too, at least once you finish the IB, if not during the IB. So don't forget about CAS. Don't kind of push it to the side, just do it. Do it regularly so you don't have too much workload and it'll be much easier. So now that we've gone through what is CAS, the elements of CAS and some tips, we're gonna finish up with some common misconceptions about CAS quickly. And then I'll move on to any questions that you guys have. So one misconception is you can just write all of your reflections at the end of the CAS activity. This is false because it's much better to write them as you do the activity. This means that you'll at least know what you were doing during the activity. You'll know what you were thinking about it, what you learned, what you liked, what you didn't like, and you can put that into a much more meaningful reflection. If you leave it to the end, chances are you'd have forgotten what you actually did for the CAS activity, and you won't know what you were doing, what you were thinking, and you won't be able to write it that well. Plus, this will probably be pushing into end of year exams time when you don't want to be thinking about CAS. So try and finish them as to doing the activity. That's a much better strategy. Second misconception is that evidence has to be really detailed. This is so wrong because evidence is one of the easiest parts of the CAS program. It can be anything showing that you've done the activity. It can be a picture of you doing it, like I showed in the first few slides with the evidence thing. It's really anything that shows you've done it. So don't let anyone tell you evidence is a hard portion of CAS. It is the easiest part of CAS. Another misconception is that you can finish CAS off in the first year of your IB. Like I said, CAS is an ongoing process. You have to be doing it even during your second year, but you can do the harder parts of CAS in your first year, meaning that you can maybe do the CAS project in your first year, or you can do more of your service activities in the first year so that your second year is less of a strain when you anyway have more commitments with your IB. Another misconception that a lot of us went into the IB thinking is that CAS isn't important because it's not graded. We soon found out with lots of lectures from our CAS supervisors that this is wrong. CAS is a pass or fail system, and you need to pass CAS to pass your IB. And apart from that, it's a really good one to make you into a more well-rounded and multifaceted person. This misconception is something that actually, it's a mistake I made when I first started CAS, thinking that it's better to do loads of activities in CAS. No one really told me what CAS is when I started the IB, so I just assumed if I do loads of things for CAS, because I used to go walking a lot, so if I put that down for CAS, if I go to the gym and put that for CAS, I go swimming, put that down for CAS. I play instruments, put those down for CAS too. I just put everything I could possibly think of down for CAS. And this was a really bad idea, as my CAS supervisor later told me. She said that It's great that you're doing all these things. You're definitely doing a lot for CAS, but that also means you have to have reflections for all that. You have to have evidence for all that. And you have to have all of those as CAS activities, which, as I soon came to realize, is not at all possible with the workload of the IB. So with CAS, less is more. You should aim to have around 2 activities per CAS element, which is what I ended up doing and which really helped me to manage my workload. So I have 2 action activities, 2 creativities, 2 service, and a CAS project. Those are 7 things you need to do over 2 years, which is really manageable. It's really easy to fit that into your workload. So just make sure you have a good plan for CAS. Less is more, remember that. Don't make the mistake I made, and you'll be fine to plan CAS around your workload. And this last misconception is that CAS goes on until final exams. If you plan your CAS timeline well, then it will not go on until final exams. You should finish it by around February, March, April of the second year of your IB, which is well before mocks and May exams will start. So you have enough time to revise. But however, keep in mind, if you have not planned your CAS timeline well, if you perhaps haven't done your CAS project, or you haven't done some of the evidence or reflections for your CAS activities and they're not ticked off, then your supervisor will force you to continue with CAS even during that time when you want to be revising. And if you don't continue with CAS and you fail it, then regardless of how well you've done, you'll fail the IB. So to make sure that you don't do that, just make sure that you've planned it well, finish it off in time, and ticked it all off. So to make sure that you are a person who has done CAS and completed it in good time, we have a 5-point checklist here. Maybe take a picture of it if you want to use it for later on. Make sure that you do all of these 5 things and you'll be fine to pass CAS. So first up is have 2 activities for each CAS element. Don't do what I did. Don't do loads of them. Just have 2. 2 is more than enough for each CAS element. Have meaningful and regular reflections that you do as you're doing the activities. Have evidence for your CAS activities. Remember, it can be anything at all that shows you're doing it. So just make sure you upload it. Always be doing 1 CAS activity at any given time, so it's a continual process. And have a well-planned and meaningful CAS project. So if you're able to tick off all of these 5 things, you should be able to plan it well, finish your CAS off well before your final May exams, and have a pretty relaxing CAS experience with the IB. So if you do want some more information about CAS, the IB, universities in the UK, US, and global universities, or really anything to do with academics and career advice, do go onto Millie's website. If you want to see some of the upcoming panels and webinars that we have, check out the QR code at the top right of the screen. We have some really great content coming up. And for more updates, do follow our Instagram, LinkedIn, Facebook, and or Twitter accounts. So that brings us to the end of this presentation. I'll now just check if there are any questions. Okay, so I see a question saying, you mentioned that your school did a trip to Nepal. I see a lot of schools doing these CAS trips. Is it okay that a lot of students from one school do the same CAS project? So yes, it's completely fine if a lot of people do the same CAS project because CAS is personal to you. So even if you're working in a big group and everyone's doing the same thing, that's completely fine. The IB won't mind. All that you need to make sure you're doing is that you're doing something as part of that CAS project. So it shouldn't be that you just sign up for it, but you don't go for the meetings, you don't do anything. As long as you are actively taking a role in that project, it's completely fine. So I hope that answers that question. If you guys have any more questions about CAS or even about the IB, if you're just starting your IB or you've already started, any questions at all, please do ask them. I'll be more than happy to share my experiences and help. So another question is, when do we start filling out reflections? So ideally, since I said at the beginning, you have 3 learning outcomes per activity and 1 reflection per learning outcome, perhaps you should do them as you're doing the activity. So maybe do 1 at the start when you're just starting out. So what are your impressions of the activity? What are the goals you want to achieve? Then maybe do 1 in the middle of the activity. So saying if you're on the road to achieving those goals, how it's going. And then 1 at the end saying, looking back, how was the activity? What did you learn from it? What did you like? What did you not like at all? And then reflection that way. So you can fill them out either at the end of the activity or right at the beginning or in the middle, but I would suggest doing them as you're doing the activity so you always have something to talk about. Any more questions at all, feel free to ask them. Sure, there are no more questions. Anything at all, guys. If you have anything to ask, even about general questions about the IB, I'll be happy to answer anything. Or if you have any questions after, then you can contact me via my email address. I'll be happy to answer them too. Okay, so if there aren't any questions at this time, then thank you guys so much for coming online. I know it's your summer holidays, so thank you for taking the time to watch this. I hope now you know a bit more about CAS and are going into the IB, knowing more about CAS and a bit more confident about it. Good luck for your IB and for CAS, obviously, and thanks for coming on.